and welcome to week one of our MOOC, English as a Medium of Instruction for Academics. This is my colleague, Rob Baird.
Hello.
And I'm Mary Page. We hope you've enjoyed the tasks so far this week, and this is our video recording in which we'll comment on some of the things that have been happening in the MOOC and try and make a few helpful suggestions as to how you might get the most out of your time with us. Over to you, Rob. What would you like to say as a welcome to our friends across the world?
Well, I would like to say, first of all, thank you very much for participating. We've already sort of started off with some brilliant conversations, lots of people jumping in immediately and commenting as we wanted you to do. People are often slow to communicate with each other and comment on other people's comments, but that's happening already. And we can see some familiarity, some people noticing that people are from the same contexts or similar contexts, people asking interesting questions.
Yes.
So thank you very much for that. And also, I was going to raise just some interesting suggestions for how we conceived of the MOOC. So we wanted this to be a space where people come in with their own experiences and their own ideas, and we give you like the framework, but you come in and you share your own context. So you make our ideas relevant or not relevant. We're very welcome to criticism for where you are. And a few people have already asked questions to say, well, this is, or maybe this isn't new where I am, or this is an area that is... seems different in this context compared to my context, and we absolutely welcome that discussion. We absolutely want you to come in and to contextualize the discussions that people are having, because this is a very, very wide community. This is an emerging practice, and it exists in different forms around the world, and you are participating by commenting and sharing your knowledge with us, just as we are feeding little pieces of our knowledge with you. So
yes.
Thank you.
Yes. So please think of Rob and us and me as facilitators. We don't know everything about EMI. We just want to have this space for you to learn from one another. Just moving on to one or two little points about managing your experience on the MOOC. It may be the first time that you've worked in this way. And if I could just ask you to think carefully about the time that you have that's available to you to give to this MOOC, and perhaps if you can make it available, say every day at the same time, even if it's in only 5, 10 minutes or 15 minutes, try and do it at the same time every day, and get into the habit of participating. And also, if you really are pushed for time, and I guess vast majority of us are teachers, if you're really pushed for time, look at the content of the whole MOOC and try and pick out the bits that are going to be of most interest to you so you get the most out of it. We feel, and Rob's already mentioned this, that participation is the most important feature of our MOOC, learning from one another. So when you perhaps devote an hour to working on the MOOC, you want to press forward, but we would like you to go back, wouldn't we, Rob, and look back at some of the comments that have been made, perhaps to a comment that you made, because people are working at different paces. They've all got their own speed.
Mm.
So go forward, but do look back at the same time.
Yeah,
and we feel that that will be really helpful to you, because somebody may make a comment building on a discussion that you've already been a part of, and we wouldn't like you to miss that. All right? So if we just think about this participation, one of the things we like to do when we're talking to you on a Friday afternoon is just mention a few of the discussions that have been going on. And I've started making a list of names of people who participate very frequently. We've got Priscilla, Fahad, Anastasia, Izu, Asaya, Yumi. I can't name everybody, but we are trying to read everything that you write and as much as possible, just like or make a quick comment, but we are noticing what you say. There was a fabulous conversation going on between Deborah, Jessica, Yumi, Elizabeth, Priscilla, Tatiana, Eileen, and I think a few more people, talking about the pressure to motivate students in secondary schools to learn English so that they come to their higher education with a certain level of proficiency in English in order to be able to learn through the medium of English. And we do recognise that there are these different levels of proficiency when students come to the EMI context in higher education. And we do realise the pressures that are being put on you, the challenges that you're facing. And somebody mentioned the craft of teaching skills. And this is something that I think we need to focus on and highlight as much as possible, because it's not just language, it's your teaching skills that we want you to build on in order to be able to manage this phenomenon of EMI. I could go on and on talking about this, but I'm conscious of time, and I do know that Rob would like to go on and on. So you've got some notes, haven't you, of discussions you've been following.
Yes, I mean, yeah. When I click like on people's discussions, I actually am liking what people are bringing to the course very much. And a key thing this week has been contextualisation, as I said before. So we've got lots of people who are teachers in schools, lots of people dealing with learners in different environments, and that brings different pressures. So we said English is a medium of instruction for academics, but clearly how people relate to, or how people have been educated and experience English before they arrive in the EMI higher education context. I apologise for the noise outside, by the way, but I hope you can still hear me. So how they arrive there and the context, the educational context around English is important. So we're welcoming in these conversations, and also people who are language teachers or study skills support staff also bring a certain value and a certain sort of direction to the EMI context, which is very interesting, and this course facilitates conversations around that. I was interested in some discussions raised by Egueda, Fiona, Natida, who talked about different contexts and mentioned the essentially what we want to do through this course that I mentioned before is that realizing that EMI is so broad, we can only really give it meaning and give solid suggestions that would relate to your context. So people are talking about, say, post-colonial context where English has a history as a second language or an official language, compared to newer context where English is being chosen as part of internationalisation, for example. And also relating to the sceptic versus negotiator versus optimist perspective on globalisation. We've got different contexts. I'd be very interested to hear about access issues within EMI. So does this present, or does English being the medium of instruction present access difficulties for people from certain backgrounds? So Natida talked about Thailand and how she perceives certainly a problem within Thailand whereby people in urban areas find it difficult to access or to get the English skills that can access higher education. So it's a really interesting conversation, and I'd like to hear more about that.
So many things we'd love to pick up on with you. And you do mention tremendous challenges that you face. We feel quite privileged, Rob and I, in the situation that we work in. And we know it's not the same for everybody. And yet, despite these challenges, people like you are speaking and discussing about EMI in such a positive way, despite all of the challenges and the questions and the problems. And you're speaking with warmth and enthusiasm and great positivity and motivation. And we can see that this community we wish to build international academics networking with one another is a very, very positive thing to build on and to work towards. And it's strange how it's on the one hand very local. You have to make your local decisions, what's best for you and what's best for your students. Yet at the same time, we have this very international and global perspective. I think this makes it so absolutely wonderful to explore together. However, we have got three specific questions that we'd like to move on to. And the first one...
We will do quickly. Yes.
Is from Salam. And you will find these questions in section 1.20, where this video will appear very, very shortly. First one is from Salam about students who study in EMI. Will they be able to communicate their ideas to ordinary people and customers when they start their job? And Rob, you'd like to get going on this, wouldn't you?
Yes, I can. Well, answer very simply that, like with any education or any course, be it in English or in people's first language, the goals of the course or what people learn will be decided by the methodologies applied and how people decide to train people. Teaching through English does not bring about any definite results. So I wouldn't say the answer to the question of whether EMI will help people to communicate in real life situations, there isn't a clear answer. Some courses might prioritise that as a goal. Other courses might be highly theoretical and there will be little language gain through studying through English. And there are research shows on some courses there are limited gains to people's language when they study through English, to people's English language when they study through English. And at other times there are, because it's simply an educational goal. So the answer is it depends.
Salam says, how can the lawyer or the chemist communicate their ideas to customers of different language backgrounds? I think underpinning the three questions that we have today is this awareness, the need to listen to the person you're communicating with and adapting your own speech, your ideas, to meet people in a way that both of you can communicate with one another. So I would say that it is awareness of cultural differences, the situation, the language being used, and the individual that you're talking to. And that happens really in any context, doesn't
yes.
it?
Yes, I was going to say, we should mention that will be coming up in future weeks. So we don't want to answer everything.
No. Okay, no, we don't. Okay. Let's move on to a question by Jatin Hatin Mohan. To what extent you believe that EMI can help in strengthening the interconnection of the world by using English language as a lingua franca? And then he goes, or she goes, I'm terribly sorry, I don't know if it's he or she, I'm really sorry. Goes on to talk about the elitism that exists between native speakers and non-native speakers and so on. Rob, your first thoughts on this?
Okay, yes, I think it raises a really important point that often discussions of native speaker English and native speaker status are not limited to native speakers of English. And that's one thing raised here, that when a particular form of language is valued, anybody who is seen to have that as their ability or seen to speak that as their variety more than somebody else will be advantaged. And this elitism is inherent within education.
Yes.
And in higher education as well. We know we might study sociolinguistics and we might talk about equality and fairness a lot, but we are also aware that our universities do contain a lot of biases. They do contain a lot of inequality. So that I don't think anything will ever enhance the interconnection of the world perfectly, but I don't think anything that connects people will ever destroy interconnections in the world. It's all, again, it depends.
It depends.
There will be some positive steps being taken because of the connection between people. But yes, we have to be really, really careful in how we deal with powerful discourses like English and education generally, because it can exclude people, as we mentioned with Thailand, for example.
And our third question is from Ottavio. My question to Mary and Rob is, to what extent EMI is taken as formal methodology for teaching in higher education? It's not a methodology. It definitely isn't.
Okay. Context.
Yes, absolutely. What capacities should I try to develop in order to successfully use EMI when teaching global business or whatever subject? And so I think we've already kind of hinted at our approach to this in a way. In the sense that, as Rob said, we identify the needs of the students and we make choices appropriate to their needs and the goals of the course, the module, the programme you're teaching. What capacity should I try to develop? The ones that we're going to mention later in the course, really, to do with intercultural communication and an understanding of where different people are coming from.
And I think a big part of the course as well is raising your self-awareness, because what capacities should I develop? Part of that is understanding what capacities you have, what capacities would benefit your students. And you only really know that when you start engaging with other educators who can explain what capacity or what they need, what they have and what they struggle with. Lots of people will realise they have lots of positive qualities that they hadn't thought about before. So,
yeah. So thank you very much indeed for those questions. We could talk longer and longer about them, but this is a wonderful start. So we hope that when we come to point 20 or whatever it is in week two, that we'll find some more questions awaiting us and that we'll be able to answer in this video recording. Just one more thing to mention before we draw to a close, and that is, you know, we keep talking about our community. In order to establish this community, we do have a Facebook group which goes by the name of this same MOOC. We know that Facebook isn't available to everybody. We know that some people don't like Facebook, but it's what we have at the moment in order to create an extension of the space that we're creating on the MOOC. So please, if you fancy joining our Facebook group, you'll be very, very welcome.
So that's English as a Medium of Instruction for Academics. If you search for that on Facebook,
yes,
you can meet other people who've done this course,
yes,
on previous runs.
Yeah. And we're hoping to exchange ideas. It's a place where you can ask questions after the MOOC has finished. Do we have anything else to say, Rob?
Just once again, thank you very much for
thank
participating
you.
And I hope you continue to get value from this and
thank
from
you
the
very
discussion.
Much.
Thank you.
Yeah. See you next week.
See you next
week.
Bye-bye.